I was always interested in science. As a kid, I was building model rockets. I was performing chemical experiments in my basement, and one time I almost blew up my parents' basement trying to build a laser. So when the physics professor that was next door neighbor to my grandparents invited me to a lecture on lasers, I was eager to attend. I was a 6'2" lanky 13-year-old. So when I sat down, right away someone asked me to move because I was blocking his view. But little did I know who that person was or the effect that the work that he did would have on my career. After that lecture, I asked my professor friend, and he said, "Oh, that was Bob Noyce, chairman of Intel." It turns out he had been a student of this professor some years before, and the professor had shown him some of the first transistors from Bell Labs and told him these were important. And just less than 10 years after this, Bob Noyce co-founded Intel with Gordon Moore. The transistor is like a switch, and it's in all of our computers. So you think of it as a switch that you switch with your finger, except the transistor is switched by an electrical voltage applied to a central contact. In 1965, Gordon Moore observed that the chips they were making had double the number of transistors every 2 years. This became known as Moore's Law, and that trend has continued till today. So now the biggest computer chips have billions of transistors. Some people have speculated that these supercomputers will continue this trend and a supercomputer will shrink to the size of the grain of sand. But that's not physically possible, you see. Parts of the transistor are already approaching atomic dimensions where quantum mechanical effects limit its performance. So we think that we can only go about a factor of 16 denser in transistors on a chip before we reach the end of the game. So Moore's Law is ending, and with it, the wave of technology that I've ridden most of my career. And so what comes next? Is this really the end of more powerful computing? These questions dogged me. So that 5 years ago, I said, I need to shift the research focus more toward new computational paradigms. And some of those, for example, that people have considered are optical computing, quantum, neuromorphic, and even DNA computing. But today I'll speak of quantum computing and neuromorphic or cognitive computing, which I think are the most promising. In today's computers, again, the transistor acts like a switch. It's either on in the state one or off in the state zero. It can't be in both states. It's only in one of those states at a time. But physicists have studied atoms and find they behave quite differently. An atom has discrete or quantized energy levels, and that's where the idea of quantum mechanics comes from. We can label the two lowest levels a zero state and a one state. And the surprising thing is that scientists have found that atoms can exist in both states simultaneously. This is called a quantum superposition state. And that bothered Richard Feynman, who's a Nobel Prize winning physicist, because Feynman looked at that and he said, that's a problem, because our classical computers have to grow exponentially in size in order to simulate real reality, which is atoms. To explain why that's so, consider simulating as a number of two-level atoms. If we have two-level atoms, to simulate them requires 4 2-bit states, both in the zero state, both in the one state, and then each one in the one state. So that's 4 states. 4 atoms requires 16 states. 10 atoms requires 1,024 states. And you say to me, well, what's this guy talking about, 1,024? We have big computers that can do that in a billionth of a second. That's true, but I'd like you to consider just 10 times more, 100 atoms. Now how long would this simulation take? And the answer is 3 million years using the largest computer that we now have executing 10,000 trillion executions per second. This is the fact that Feynman realized, that our current computational paradigm cannot simulate even a modest number of atoms in all their quantum mechanical behavior. And that's what he saw as the problem. But being a clever guy, he found a solution. He said, why don't we make things called quantum bits or qubits? And if they can exist in superposition states, Then I can simulate 100 atoms with 100 qubits. And in a short time, because it will be exponentially accelerated, because they exist in those superposition states. So how would we build such a technology? Scientists around the world, including in our group at IBM, are looking at different ways to make qubits. Some are spins on an electron or an atom. It's like a magnetic moment or a little magnet that points up or down. Others are like the atom that I've already described in ions or atoms in crystals. And still others, like we are developing at IBM, are superconducting circuits that behave like atoms, that has energy levels. In all of these, you can get quantum superposition states. But these quantum states are very easy to disturb. So many of these new technologies are in a vacuum and cooled to a very low temperature, in fact, to within almost below a tenth of a degree within absolute zero in order for them to work. We've already demonstrated with our technology to the right there, three coupled qubits that show this quantum superposition with high fidelity. We've also been able to factor like a number like 15 into the primes 5 and 3. We've executed small database search programs. And you say, well, that's pretty trivial. But the point is that unlike transistor computing, every qubit we add doubles our computational capacity. So we just have to add enough qubits and control them, and we'll have exponentially faster computation than we have today, and be able to calculate intractable things, like designing new molecules for new drugs that you really can't do today. Just like Feynman envisioned, we would be able to simulate physical reality as it really is in the quantum sense. And the other aspect is neuromorphic or cognitive computing. Imagine the usefulness of a computer that could do what a small child does, understand language, be able to learn and create new things, recognize objects and people accurately while consuming only a few watts, where today the largest computers consuming megawatts can't do as well as a child at these tasks. That's why we feel different approaches required for learning, recognition, and inference in machines. Yes, people have tried it for years. But in fact, one of the differences is that in a computer, every transistor that I described is connected to 5 or 10 other transistors. However, in the brain, the neurons, or basic brain cells, have inputs from 10,000 other neurons through structures called synapses, which is shown in that red outlined insert there. And these synapses are like connections between all the neurons. And they change when we learn things, so we believe a large part of the memory in the brain is stored in the synapses. And so memory and computation are distributed throughout the brain rather than contained in separate regions like in computer chips today. That makes the brain very hard to understand. But people are working to study this, and this is a video from Misha Ahrens and his group at Howard Hughes Medical Institute. This is the brain of a transparent zebrafish that has been genetically engineered so the neurons fluoresce when they are active. And this shows how complex the brain is. We're only beginning to understand the brain, and we need similar data on mammals that have real recognition, more like humans, in order to understand the algorithms or the recognition that's being used in the brain. So we already have, inspired by biology, algorithms that work pretty well, like speech recognition in your cell phones. That works well, but it's not quite as accurate as a human, and it's not as efficient, and it doesn't understand speech, as you must have noticed. Now, IBM has created this Watson computer that was able to defeat Jeopardy champions, but it still is 10,000 times less efficient than the human brain. So we need new cognitive technologies that my group and others are working on that have memory that behaves more like these synapses in the brain. New technologies coupled with new algorithms will make highly efficient cognitive computers. Finally, I would say that we aren't trying to create a brain. I'll be very clear about that. We want to take inspiration from the brain to create cognitive technologies that are useful to us, just like the Wright brothers took inspiration from birds to create airplanes, not giant mechanical wing-flapping birds. And that's the difference. We need cognitive technologies to sort through the vast amounts of information we're flooded with to find useful knowledge. It's almost like an answer to the rhetorical question T.S. Eliot posed. Where is the wisdom we have lost in knowledge? Where is the knowledge we have lost in information? Yes, Moore's law, although it is ending, there is a new wave of computation that is even greater in efficiency and promise that is just beginning with cognitive and quantum computing, and I am glad to be a part of that. Thank you.